Thank you, Marta, for that kind introduction, and thank you for coming out. Wow, I know this is the busiest day of the year, the first day of the semester, and the turnout is quite impressive. As Marta said, I'm a historian. So the first thing I did when I got this campus interview was I got on Amazon and I ordered the Griffin History of the University of Kansas. And a couple things surprised me there. First of all, I already knew a little bit about the founding of the university, but I was very interested in those first chapters. I actually study slavery and the Atlantic slave trade. And the linkage between this university and this town and abolition was quite interesting to read about, something I knew something of, but really found fascinating. And the second thing that struck me in there, I read through, I noticed that this college has never had a historian as the dean, so I think it's high time that you had that. But you have had a historian as the chancellor. Anybody knew who that was? Anybody? You haven't read your history. Actually, Frank Strong, who the Strong Building is named after, was a historian. He, like I, published in the American Historical Review, which is considered the best journal in our field. He published a really interesting piece on Cromwell's strategy in the West Indies. I published a piece on something called the Black Rice Debate, which is a debate over whether African technologies were important for the establishment of rice plantations in South Carolina. So anyway, as I read Griffin's history, I was sort of struck by Strong, Chancellor Strong, and his time here. He was chancellor from 1902 to 1920. And he faced four challenges right at the start of his tenure as chancellor. The first was funding. And he gave a speech in 1907 where he said, there are only two ways of dealing with this emergency, and that was an emergency in state funding for the university. Either to do away with the institution and hand it over to some other agency, which is unthinkable, or else adequately provide for its present and future needs. The second challenge you faced kind of can be summed up in the presence of a guy named William Carruth. And Carruth was a humanist, a Germanist. And he was actually the main contender, he was the other choice when they were looking for a provost. And Carruth led a group of humanist faculty who were, and I quote again, convinced that science and the scientist had excessive fame and prestige, i.e. student credit hours, grants, these sorts of things. And Carruth and his group were also concerned with, and I quote again, the overemphasis on intercollegiate sports and especially football. This is the kind of stuff you can't write fiction about because no one would believe it. And fourth, his fourth challenge really had to do with the purpose of the university, the purpose of higher education. And Strong, being a historian, spoke right actually at his inauguration. He looked back in time, looked back at the period from the 1830s up through the latter part of the 19th century. And he talked of this period as being one of what he called excessively material, being excessively materialistic and individualistic. And he said, and I quote from his speech, commercialism became rampant. And the purely utilitarian idea of education was strongly felt. And this was something he opposed. He thought university education should be something more than a utilitarian purpose of going out and getting a job. And what he did is he looked to the Wisconsin, and looked to Wisconsin, the Wisconsin idea. Now, we never actually got a Kansas idea. But this period in the early part of the 20th century for the university really was one in which the university embraced some progressive values. And for Strong, the university was about really finding a place that reached out to the public, that was concerned with the affairs of the state and with the community, and also was concerned with a quest for truth. Now, as I read through this, I thought a couple of things. First, clearly, we face today many challenges in higher education, but we've always faced challenges in higher education. If you look back to the turn of the 20th century, we faced a lot of challenges. Some of those challenges we face today are unique to the 21st century, but some of them obviously have been with us for a while. So with that in mind, I want to walk you through five of the ideas that I have for challenges of liberal arts and science colleges, and as it says, how KU will or might address them. So my first challenge is affordability or public perceptions of it. And this is something I pulled off your website. This is in-state tuition at KU from 1975 through the present. And you can see that it's gone up dramatically. Now, if this were any other university in the country, public university, it would look quite similar. Michigan State, same thing. but tuition clearly has outpaced inflation. It's actually outpaced growth in the cost of healthcare. Now, you add to that the fact that most students borrow. So we're looking at about $9,000 and a bit for tuition here today. Add to that fees, books, room and board, this sort of thing, and you're looking at a price tag north of $20,000, maybe $25,000 a year, so 4 years of education, $100,000. On top of that, we're talking about borrowing, and this is certainly something that's in a lot of news about this today. You've got Hillary Clinton talking about it and Marco Rubio talking about it, so it's an issue on the left and the right. But here at KU, the average student, about 50% of students borrow and they walk away after 5 years with about $25,000 in debt. Now, why is this a concern? This is a concern partly because of things like this, the public perception of the university not being affordable, public education not being affordable anymore. Now, what are we going to do about that? I'll talk a little bit later in my time about why this is, why university is less affordable, and I think we all know some of these reasons. But you know, what do we do to address this? A few quick things. I think we need to change the conversation. I don't think we should only talk about cost. We should also talk about value. And there's no doubt today that higher education is a very valuable thing. College graduates do much better with their lifelong earnings than people who do not graduate from college. The second thing I think we should do is financial advising for students. I like to tell students when I have a few moments with them that they should live like a student today so they don't have to live like one in the future. When I showed up to college, literally, I had two bags. I see moving vans coming in today and TVs being unloaded. But what can we do more practically in liberal arts and sciences? I think one thing we can do is to focus on the four-year graduation rate. And I know this is something that comes up over and over in discussions here, and it's really featured in Bold Aspirations. The four-year graduation rate here is 36%. That's actually fairly behind some of the peer institutions that you might look to: Missouri, Nebraska, Colorado, Oregon. Michigan State, we have a four-year graduation rate of just north of 50%. And the six-year graduation rate here is about 61%. Now, what does that have to do with affordability? It has a fair amount to do with affordability. This is a study that was done of Temple University and University of Texas. And what you can see here is the amount of debt that students accumulate after 4 years goes up exponentially when they enter the fifth and the sixth year. So if we're talking to students about coming into a university and enrolling, one of the concerns is debt. You can keep that debt low if you graduate in 4 years. If you graduate in 5 or 6 years, the debt goes up pretty significantly. Whoops, let me go back to that. Sorry. There we go. So, what do I think that can be done about this? First of all, I think I've spoken a lot with folks today about the KU core. I've read the KU core, I've looked at Bold Aspirations. I think clearly there needs to be some continued review of majors, continued consideration of the KU core and Bold Aspirations to see exactly what this does to four-year graduation rates. Second, I think one thing that the college could focus on is advising and advising. Again, this is part of Bold Aspirations, I think it's important. Getting students to focus on what courses they take and to plot a reasonable course toward a four-year graduation. Along that lines, one thing I'm particularly struck with is something that's done at Arizona State. They have a very impressive e-advising system where students get regular updates. I don't know if students check emails, maybe they push them to them some other way, but they get regular updates about their progress. And indeed, they actually run analytics on students. This is something of a debate at MSU about whether or not this should be done or not. I think it's a pretty good idea. But they run analytics of students, and they tell them how they're doing and what a typical student who has these grades and is taking these courses, what their time to degree would be and how they would do in the major. So quite obviously, you know, you've got a C minus in statistics. Chemistry and physics probably aren't majors that you're going to be successful at. You ought to think about these other things. You've done very well in this writing class. Maybe you ought to think about these majors just to get students to focus on how they might succeed at a university. A third thing that I know you're doing more and more of here is meaningful first-year experiences. We do that in MSU, and I think students take a lot of it out of it, these small first-year seminars where students establish personal relationships with faculty members and really find a place at universities. And last, something that I know this college has been thinking about, I think KU is a bit behind on developing this, but something we've done quite successfully at Michigan State University, and particularly in the history department. The history department has been the most aggressive department in this sphere, but online courses. The history department at Michigan State University over the last 5 years since I've been chair has developed in-house 25 online courses that run during the summer. Actually, this past summer, we cut a couple of them. We're down to about 22 or 23. Those other ones are just sitting in the bank. But we offered this summer 23 online courses to over 1,000 students. 1,093 students took the history department's online courses alone. Now, part of the reason we do this is for revenue. And the history department at Michigan State University, we get to keep 75% of the tuition from online courses. So it's quite lucrative for the department. The last 4 years, we've made about $1 million a year in the department alone from these courses. But I think particularly important with regard to this is what online summer courses do is they allow students to go home. If they work, they can work their summer jobs, they can live at home where they don't have to pay room and board, and they can make productive use of their summers. If you take two or three classes, maybe just one, but if you take a couple of classes a summer for a few years, that's one semester's work. That's one more semester you don't have to be in residence. And it's a very, very good way to get students thinking about having a year-round educational experience, but also moving more quickly toward time to degree. The second challenge I see colleges facing, universities generally, is budget. Now, there's not an institution in the country, there's certainly not a corporation that would be expected to cut and still be excellent, but that's what we're asked to do. We're asked to cut our way to excellence. This is something else that I pulled off your website. This is from Bold Aspirations, and this is current dollars, the amount of funding from the state general fund that goes to that the university gets for each student, for the full-time equivalent. And you can see how that has gone down, down, down. And again, if you looked at any public university in the country, you would see a very similar chart, drop in state appropriations for public universities. And again, this is part of the reason, obviously, that universities are so expensive these days. Now, you add to that this. You add to this trends in R&D by agency, and you can see the big ones that we would draw on, NSF particularly, also NIH here, DOE here, DOD here. But you can see since 2008, a pretty steady decline in that. So that's a second revenue stream that universities might call on that has decreased. This doesn't include 2015, but 2015 was down again. Peeled out of that, this actually was in that little other category, but I get a lot of NIH, NEH grants for digital humanities type projects. I've had several in recent years, and you can see that NEA is down and the National Institute for the Arts is down. So all these funding streams for universities down. This isn't a KU figure, this is a national figure. I just thought I'd throw it up here because one of the assumptions that many people make, part of the national dialogue, is that the reason for university tuition escalating is that we're overspending. We're building, climbing walls, swimming pools, luxury apartments, all these sorts of things. But in reality, nationwide, if you look at current dollars, the spending on students has not increased nationwide. It's this drop in state appropriations and increase in other revenue streams that account for the increase in tuition, part of the problem with the budget. So this is the 2014. I didn't have access to the this year's budget at the time, but this is your budget for the entire university, and you can see the areas, tuition and fees, contracts and grants and state appropriation, about two-thirds of everything. And then you've got some other figures over there, gifts being important at 4%. So what do we do in the face of a budget like this? A couple of things. I think first, this state appropriations thing. I read the New York Times article that came out about Kansas as one-party state and whether or not you're going to have no income tax or what's going to happen with revenues in the future in the state. So that's hard to predict. But I certainly think that one thing we can do is to really let it be known the importance of the university, the importance of what we do here, and how this university, how this college has an impact on the state, how things we do actually impact the lives of people around the state. MSU has a terrific website called Spartan Impact, and it looks at the impact of the state. It charts it out very clearly. They roll this thing out for the legislature all the time, exactly what our engagement is with communities across the state of Michigan. I think that's important to let the state know. The second thing I think we have to do is to be entrepreneurial. One thing that is happening here, it certainly has happened at Michigan State, we started about 5-6 years ago, is the admission of more international students. Now, why is that happening? I hope it's happening because it makes the university a more lively place. Got the opportunity for people from many, many different cultures to come here and engage with the state of Kansas and with your students, and I think that's terrific. But obviously the other reason has to do with this. You're not going to increase dramatically in-state tuition, and out-of-state international students pay 2 or 3 times the rate of in-state students. So admitting more international students certainly is an avenue toward solving some, at least increasing the revenues of the university. Right now, KU's international population is about 5% of the students. Michigan State University, we have 14%. And we, again, I think this makes the place quite lively. It certainly, since 2008, has been a terrific revenue generator for us. Now, I caution here that the admission of international students certainly is not, you just admit them and everything's hunky-dory. There are a lot of costs that go into this. I'm very impressed with the International Academic Accelerator Program, which is a way to integrate students into this campus, make sure their English skills are up to snuff. I think that absolutely has to be done. And then a couple of other things have to be thought about. We have about 4,500 or a few more students from China, and I mean, you'd think it's great. They all integrate in with the student body and everybody's learning from each other. As it turned out, the Chinese students tend to hang out with the Chinese students and the students from Michigan tend to hang out with students from Michigan. So when you have these international populations, you certainly have to take some time and make sure that the students are actually getting to know each other and learning from each other. A second thing that I think can be done on the entrepreneurial front has to do with MAs and certificate programs, and I think especially in the online environment. At MSU, the geography department, for example, the chair of the geography department got his PhD here. He's got Kansas roots. He set up a really fantastic program in continuing education, and he gives certificates for folks who want to learn GIS and other geography skills. And as it turns out, professionals want to do this. There's a room for this, and they're doing quite well in that market. The MSU School of Social Work, which is also in my college, I'm in the College of Social Science, does some similar things with continuing education. They cleared $4.5 million in offering continuing education courses to social workers across the state last year. So this is quite a nice market. Most of their classes are online, although they do send faculty out to the communities to work with social workers as well. And finally, in the history department, we have done quite well with online courses. I mentioned our 23 online courses that we offer. Most of those appeal to students who are already MSU students, but we do get students from across the country. When Sweetbriar College in Virginia went under last year, I picked up the phone and called every single advisor there. There's not many advisors, it was only two. But I called the advisors and I said, if your students need credits, then have them take our courses. And indeed, we got a lot of students from Sweetbriar signing up for online history courses at Michigan State University so they get credits to graduate from Sweetbriar. So I do think this is a nice niche. We've also offered non-credit courses, and we're getting ready to launch one at least, in genealogy, and we're looking into some partnerships with the College of Education to offer some courses for continuing ed credits with online for teachers in the state of Michigan. That's sort of a hard nut to crack because there's a lot of state requirements about how these courses are set up. But I do see this as another revenue stream that we should pursue in the department. Third, I think that clearly you have to consider, when you're faced with budget issues, you have to consider how resources are allocated. I'm a big proponent of cutting costs in some places, but making sure, when you have to cut, but making sure that you maintain and indeed enhance areas that are of strategic importance. This is something that echoes what you have in bold aspirations. One example of that from my own past would be when I became chair 5 years ago, I inherited a $1.1 million budget deficit, which we accumulated for any number of reasons, and I had to cut back. I had to increase revenues, which you do with online courses, but that wasn't enough. So what we did is the only thing I could cut was the size of the graduate program, graduate stipends. So we cut the size of the graduate program, took a lot of meetings of the faculty, and we really narrowed the program down to our core areas of strength, African history and African American history, these two fields that really have a lot of synergies together. And in those fields, what we did, we cut some of the size of the other fields. We actually increased the size of the graduate stipends so that we could get better students. Now, what emerged from that was a much better ranking in the field of African history and African American history. We're the top three ranked African history program in the country right now. And our students, better students come in and get a better placement. So I do think it's possible to cut budgets when necessary, but still advance these areas of strength, indeed make them stronger for the future. So let me move on from there. The third area that I see as a challenge going forward is what I will call inclusive excellence. How do you achieve inclusive excellence? And let me just tell you a little bit about the history department and some things I've done. MSU's past 5 years, as I've been chair, the number of black tenure system faculty in the department has grown from 2 to 6. And the percentage of all minorities in the department has increased from 13% to 25%, so just about doubled. And the ratio of female to male faculty has reached about a 1-to-1 ratio. Now, why did we pursue this in the department over the last 5 years? Why was this a priority? I mean, my own personal pitch to the department, something that I hold quite dear, is that I truly believe we reach better solutions in our research, better solutions in our teaching, better solutions in our outreach when we listen to ideas from people with a range of experiences and a range of backgrounds. I think in order to have a strong, vibrant department, no matter what it is, chemistry, physics, history, English, dance, you name it, you've got to have a diverse faculty and you've got to have diverse graduate students and a diverse undergraduate student population. Now, how did we get there? We got there partly by just broad and open dialogue. I sat down with, I actually appointed when I became chair, a good friend of mine who teaches African American history, Pero Dagbovi, and the two of us made this a priority. We had department discussions and we reached out to the dean and the provost office to make this a point of emphasis for the history department. Every time we had a meeting about hiring, about our hiring choices, if we could do something, you know, what fields do we want to hire, and we made sure we looked around the table and asked who was there, whose voice needs to be heard here, and what can we do to make this a priority, what can we do to get a number of voices heard. And then we began, as I said, to have meetings. We had a meeting with the vice president of HR, who thought it was a great idea. He freed up some funds if we could get the dean's approval for us to go ahead and try to make hires in this area, and we succeeded. So really, I think it's just a matter of sitting down and making it a priority. I think in history, when you can post a position in African American history or Chicano Latino history, chances are you're going to have a broad application pool. This isn't necessarily the case in physics, not necessarily the case in chemistry, it's not necessarily the case in a lot of departments, but I think you have to try. I think you have to make this a priority, and it's certainly something we did in the history department. Now, the second part of excellence, this is an analogy. Please don't look down here, because I really do want the job. So what this is on the y-axis, you see over here, this is the rank of teams, football teams. This is several years ago. This is actually your Weiss years, so there's a reason you're down here. This is the team rank at the end of the season for football, and this is something ESPN's recruiting rank of the classes over a four-year period. So what you see here is relatively weak recruiting classes and relatively strong recruiting classes, and then very high rank of the team at the end of the season, very low ranking team at the end of the season. Everyone who falls on this side, I actually looked for basketball because you would have been right there. Everybody who falls on this side then, they had relatively weak recruiting classes and they outperformed. So if you look at Oregon, or if you look over here at Wisconsin, TCU, Oregon had a relatively weak recruiting class, but it ended up as the top two teams in the country. Same with Wisconsin, Michigan State right here where I am. These on this side, Michigan, let's use that as an example since we don't particularly get along. Michigan had excellent recruiting class. Recruiting classes for 4 years, but finished down in the 20s. Not very good. Actually lower than that, down in the 40s. Now why am I showing you this? Again, don't tell. You have a new coach and he's gonna do great things. So why am I showing you this? I want to make an analogy to what we do at the university. Part of this to me talks about fostering a culture of excellence. Teams up here in the gray have a culture of excellence. They have outperformed what they should have performed, given the classes that they were recruited. teams down here on this side didn't. They didn't end up doing as well as their recruiting classes. And I think we need to think about higher education that way. How do we foster a culture of excellence? How do we get faculty members to outperform? How do we get graduate students and undergraduates to outperform? Part of that, I think, has to do with developing human resources, developing the resources that you have. I've been a very people-centered chair. I have made great efforts to build trust with the faculty and to be transparent in decision-making, to include a lot of people in decision-making. I think that has to be done, building trust, building relationships. And I think it's important to free up resources for faculty that you have. We very often want to chase the next shiny thing and go out and recruit other students, but you have got excellent faculty members, and you need to do all you can to move their careers along, partly because it's good for them, but also because it's good for the university. And I think this is particularly true of mid-career faculty. In a lot of disciplines, we bring in assistant professors with huge startup packages. They do great things for 6 years. They get their articles written, their NSF grants, their books written, and then boom, startup package is gone. They don't have the dissertation to fall back on, and what are you going to do now? And it's often at this period that people start families, people begin to look at other things. So how do you get people to become, again, productive at mid-career? One thing we did in the history department is I've got a little bit of play in the budget because of these online revenues, so we actually created a fund. We call it the Moral Fund because we're a land-grant institution, but we created a fund in the history department with our own dollars to give a little bit extra. Mid-career faculty can apply for this, and hopefully it helps jumpstart their careers so that they can begin to work on new projects and become productive again. The second thing I think that's important in order to foster a culture of excellence is pursuing and also retaining top talent and doing that very aggressively. I think you need, obviously you're not going to be able to go out and hire every National Academy faculty member in the country. I mean, you just don't have the money for that. But you can, on occasion, go out and hire those people. You can also go out and hire assistants or associates in fulls. You don't always have to hire assistants. I think this is particularly true if you want to jumpstart a program, get a program going again. Nothing against assistant professors. Assistant professors bring new and terrific ideas. But they're not going to be netting the NSF grants. They're not going to be advancing your graduate program immediately. One example of this for Michigan State University is when I was hired. 10 years ago, I was hired. We had one of the number one ranked, top three ranked African history programs in the country, and for a variety of reasons, that program had shrunk down to one person who was getting ready to retire. So what did the university do? They hired not one, not two, not three, but four. They made a commitment, hire four faculty members, all at the associate professor level. We hit the ground, and immediately our ranking was back to the top three again. We just added another one this year. Somebody's coming in to be the head of African Studies. So I would anticipate that I think we're the top program in the country. We'll see, for what it's worth, what U.S. News thinks. And then finally, I think something that all of these teams have, and certainly is important in academics as well, is good facilities. I mean, if you're going to attract top researchers, particularly in the STEM disciplines, you got to have top facilities. You're not going to have somebody come here who's going to have a lab that dates from the 1960s. I know there's talk about building some more buildings. It looks like you're going to get a new integrated science building. I think that's terrific, because you really do have to have great facilities. Now, all that said, I'll just fly through this. I mean, I think you're actually doing quite well here. I plucked some things off the website. In 2014, you had the strongest ever four-year span of externally sponsored research. That's terrific. You ranked 38th among national universities, and you've got a lot of top 50 ranked graduate programs. So these are all things that are fantastic, and I think the administration itself needs to be judged on this. How do things improve in the next 5 years? How do things improve in the next 10 years? Are we outperforming what we had done in the past? The fourth challenge that we face in the 21st century in liberal arts and science is right here. That is demonstrating our relevance, demonstrating our importance. And this is a chart that I plucked off your deep in some of your websites. And this is student credit hours, enrollments in the college over the last 3 years. If I went back 10 years, it would be pretty much the same trajectory. But undergraduate enrollments and graduate enrollments in the college have dropped. Now, this is a national phenomenon. I mean, you moved in 2013 from having 64.6% of the undergrads to now to having 59.9%. So obviously the decrease here, and same with graduate enrollments. And again, this is a national phenomenon. You see this in colleges of liberal arts and sciences everywhere. Certainly we've seen this at Michigan State University. Whoa, what happened there? I think timed out. Oh, it's back, okay. And then, obviously, within the college, within colleges of liberal arts and science, there have been significant enrollment shifts as well as students have moved some departments into others. So what can we do in the 21st century to demonstrate our enrollment? Well, first of all, why is this? Why do we see this? Part of it has to do with this. Now, this is a survey that UCLA does of entering freshmen, and this dates from last year, I believe, 2014. And this is the reasons that freshmen say they enrolled in university. And you can see the top four all have to do with money and jobs. That's why they want to go to university. And you can see down here, the very last one is here to make myself a more cultured person, to learn more broadly. But students are going to learn to get jobs. I mean, that's one of the things that's on the on their radar screen. Certainly as well, in addition to this, the national discourse is not a great one. I mean, you've got the governor, Rick Scott of Florida, saying that they don't need no more anthropologists. And then you've got Barack Obama apologizing for disparaging art history. And you know, this is not a particularly good discourse to have nationally about the value of some of the some of our fields in liberal arts and sciences. Added to that, you of course have students coming in with more and more AP credits, which pluck students out of some of our math classes, some of our science classes, some of our humanities classes. They'll never learn what it's like to take these classes on a university level. And then something else added to that, we've got a proliferation of international students at many of our universities. And I will tell you from experience, since we have lots of, I don't know why that's happening, since we have lots of Chinese students at Michigan State University, international students aren't necessarily attracted to the humanities. At MSU, they concentrate in the business school, they concentrate in economics, and they concentrate in engineering. So what are the solutions for this? First, I think communication to prospective high school students and their parents and the public about what we do. And clearly what we do in liberal arts and sciences has great value. We teach skills in critical thinking, we teach skills in written, oral, and visual communication, and all of these things are valued by businesses. I know that's distracting, I have no idea. No idea. Well, we'll just forge ahead, okay? It seems to be if I stand on the mat, I'll stand still. communication. So teaching these things, I think also important skills and language are necessary in a global economy. But I think beyond that, what we do at the university is much more than train students to go out and get jobs. We, in the liberal arts and sciences, enrich lives. We enrich the lives of the students, giving them a lifelong appreciation of the arts, of literature, of cultures all over the world. And I would also refer back to something I said earlier about strong and look to the KU mission statement. The mission of KU as a public international university is to lift students in society by educating leaders, building healthy communities, making discoveries that will change the world. There's nothing in there about jobs. Clearly jobs are important, but the purpose of the university is about much, much more than that, and I think that's something we need to communicate. Second, I think what we need to do is modernize and energize our existing majors. I don't think this is the time just to sit back and say, we've done this for 1,000 years and this is the way we're going to do it. There are a lot of things we could do differently. I am fully in favor of developing internship opportunities and experiential learning opportunities for our students. The students in the history department report that this is terrific for them getting jobs. We actually have a very active program in this in the history department. The second thing we do at MSU that I think is terrific is joint majors and new minors. I'm particularly intrigued by what they do at Stanford now. I got my PhD in Stanford, but Stanford now has a CS plus X major, which is computer science plus something in the humanities. And they're doing this because folks in Silicon Valley are telling them they don't want computer scientists who only know coding. They want computer scientists who know something more broadly about the world and can think critically. I think that's quite intriguing. At Michigan State University, one thing we launched recently was a minor in digital humanities. And we're actually encouraging our students. This was in partnership with English and philosophy and a couple of other departments. But we're encouraging our students to get involved in some some coding and some web design classes, and they're loving it. Another thing that we do that I think is quite interesting is flipping the classroom, and I think there's some quite innovative teaching models that can be carried out at universities that where students are getting a lot of the content at home and they're coming into class and debating, learning from each other rather than standing or sitting and listening to a professor lecture to them like I'm doing to you. I should divide you into small groups. And third, I think that we need to develop courses that give students a 21st century skills. And let me just wrap up with this. The last challenge is the digital revolution before I turn this over to you. There are two approaches to the digital revolution. One is look at the compact disc in the MP3. The MP3 unbundled an industry and changed it dramatically. The other approach is there are three places where we send our children to grow up. The military, prison, and university, and we'll always send them to the university. I actually kind of fall somewhere in the middle. I think the digital revolution is going to bring new challenges, but I also think it brings new opportunities, and I think those opportunities lay in a few areas. One, for faculty and graduate students to have collaborative, multidisciplinary, and international grant-sponsored research opportunities, and I've certainly done a lot of this at Michigan State University. Second, I think we can encourage, encourage educational innovation. One example of this is right here in the last slide. This is actually a lab we set up in the history department. We call it LEADER, the Lab for Education in and Advancement of Digital Research. And it's an undergraduate teaching lab where students are coming, they don't listen to a faculty member, they come in and they do digital projects. They design websites rather than just write essays. And the students are developing skills that, particularly the teacher candidates, they're making this part of their teaching portfolios, and it's really doing great things for them. And our graduate students are involved in this lab, and they're finding that this gives them another skill on the job market. It's very difficult to step off into the history job market today and to find a job like mine, not as department chair, but as a faculty member. And our graduate students, increasingly, are getting DH-type jobs, which I think is something quite encouraging. So I do think that the digital revolution certainly brings with it challenges, but I think one thing we have to do is to look at the possibilities of this revolution and to really energize and transform our majors. I'll skip over this slide, and I will end with a thank you and a quote from Frank Strong, which is, we're living in the 20th century and cannot do things on the basis of the first half of the 19th. And I think that's certainly true today. We're living in the 21st century, and we shouldn't be thinking about doing things exactly like we did them at the start of the 20th century. So with that, I thank you, and I will, apparently I'm taking my own questions, so I'll throw open the floor to you. Questions? Yes, sir.
What is excellent about the college, and what are your plans for enhancing that excellence?
So the question was, what is excellent about, I'm supposed to repeat the questions for the camera, so what is excellent about the college, and what are my plans to enhance? Well, I had a slide up there, I didn't walk through it, but it was a slide of some of the top programs in the college, and I know that there are a lot of other ones within the college. So, I mean, certainly one thing, if I become the dean, I will have to do is to go door to door, go department to department, meet with chairs, but also meet with faculty, look at a lot of data, and find out more about what is excellent about the college. I do know that there are a number of very excellent programs within it, and you look at some of the particularly NSF, but also NIH and NEH grant generation, and I think that's particularly impressive in a number of the departments. I've also talked with some of the undergraduates. I had breakfast with the president of the student body, and I think this is a place that's firmly dedicated to undergraduate education, and the students leave here with a great deal. One of my best friends back in East Lansing, Alan Arbogast, he's the chair of the geography department. He went here as a graduate student, I think as an undergrad. When I got the interview, he raved about the place. And in fact, he sends his daughter from East Lansing here to go to university because he is so fond of the place and thinks it has such a dedication to undergraduates. So I think it is an excellent university. I wouldn't have applied otherwise. Excellent for research and excellent for teaching. What do I plan to do about improving it? I think, looking back at my talk, I think this involves developing the talent that you have, looking to the faculty that you have, when possible, making resources available so that faculty can advance their own careers and advance their department's reputations, and also looking to bold aspirations. I think it's important to try to recruit the best, most diverse undergraduate and graduate student populations to get them here at the university and really advance the mission. So those would be a couple of things that I would try to do. Other questions? Yes. And then I'll move over.
Revolution has really brought a lot of different tools to our, put a lot of tools in our hands, some of which can be used for the good and some maybe not. Last year, one of the biggest issues on campus was the Board of Regents social media policy, which is one that raised, again, questions about academic freedom, freedom of speech. And I was wondering to hear some thoughts from you on what some of the downsides might be of the digital revolution and how we might confront those in creative ways.
There are a lot of upsides and a lot of downsides to the digital revolution. I could go on about this for hours. Upside, I think we have the possibility to reach audiences that we never reached before, and I think that's a good thing. I think if we can take what we do more broadly, that is absolutely a positive. Upside, I've done a lot of interesting, fascinating, intellectually stimulating, and I think important to international work because of the digital revolution, because I can communicate with scholars in Brazil and carry out joint projects with people in Brazil in real time, right there on the internet. I think that's a tremendous plus and a tremendous opportunity. Upside, I think that we, no matter what the department, be it in the sciences, be it in the arts, be it in social science or the humanities, I think that we can introduce our students to some really exciting new ways to express themselves. I got tired of grading students 10-page essays and having them go to the last page, look at the grade, and then throw it in the trash can. It's really nice. I could have shown you this. This is a project that a student did. This was an undergraduate project. She, in an advanced undergraduate course, African-American undergraduate woman who wants to be a teacher, and she was tired of the portrayal of African-Americans as, this is, you know, a course about slavery. She wanted something more, so she did a project on black inventors. And you can see down here, actually, it says games. She actually learned some programming, worked with a couple of people in the lab, and made games. So you read the material on her site, the research she's done, and then you play games to see what you've learned. And she's integrated that into her teaching portfolio, and the school systems love it. I mean, she's doing terrific. So I think there's a lot of great opportunity here. Some of the downsides, I mean, I do worry long term about the structure of universities. I mean, what are you going to do when students take a course for cheap statistics course from Harvard, and they have all the skills that one would expect and want to transfer those credits in? I mean, what's that going to do to sort of basic education at the university? Is it going to turn into a two-year experience where they're coming here just to do, or coming to any university, just to do 2 years of education? I don't actually see that happening. I think parents want their kids out of the house, and I think kids want to get out of the house. But I do think it is a possibility that we will see some of the unbundling of higher education. Have to wait and see how that plays out. But on that subject, I think, you know, what colleges have to do is to be aggressive, to go out there and play in that field. You can get very, very good learning outcomes from online courses if they are done well. I look at the papers that are written in our, the essays that are written in our online courses and the ones that are written in our in-class courses, and they're quite similar. I think the learning outcomes are very similar. So I do think there are a lot of possibilities here. Now, I can't really address the specifics of squashing freedom of speech by trying to regulate these things. I mean, I, 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 I obviously don't see that as appropriate. I think there are a lot of opportunities for expression in the online environment, and faculty should be involved in doing in that. We have a lot of faculty, particularly our younger faculty, who have blogs, who tweet, who are engaged in public historical education in ways that we wouldn't have dreamed of just 10 years ago, and I really applaud them for that. The other question is, how does that kind of stuff count for tenure and promotion, or does it? And I do think there are a lot of issues to be tackled there, particularly as some of us begin to produce increasingly quite complex websites that you might have gotten NIH or NEH funding for. Does that count as a book? Does that count as an article? What are we going to do with that? I think those are conversations that have to take place. I'm actually a member of a special committee at the American Historical Association that's trying to come out with some historical recommendations for departments, for the profession, about what we will do with that. And I think that's an issue to address head on, ahead of time, rather than when you have a moment of crisis. We had a question over here.
Well, a very specific question about the online courses. So of these 23 online history courses you had in the summer, who taught those courses?
The courses were all taught by faculty, every single one of them. Most of them by tenure. Most of them by tenure system. I offer money, and some faculty respond to that incentive, and some faculty respond quite enthusiastically to that incentive. Almost all of them are taught by tenure system faculty, and I've got a few. We've got a few long term. We call them fixed terms. I don't know if you call them fixed terms or adjunct, but we've got a few adjuncts that have been with us longer than I have, and two of them teach classes. But we actually offer classes. I mean, I suppose technically that the university owns these courses, they're on our server. I have never run a course without a faculty member. I've never taken control of a course and rerun it. When faculty members have left, the courses have left with them, mostly because I want the faculty members engaged. I'm paying them to be engaged in the course. I want them engaged. I want them to keep the course up to date, and they do. Now, if the course hits a certain number where I can afford it, and the numbers hovers around 30, 35, then I assign a graduate student to the course, who is also paid. And the graduate students love this because they can go off to Nigeria, or they can go off to China, or they can go off to, as long as you have an internet connection, you can be a teaching assistant in the class. So the faculty have responded. Obviously, we've had 20-some faculty develop courses. Some have developed more than one course. And I've had absolutely no complaints about the way this is done. We do it all in-house, too. This has all been produced by the history department. Obviously, there's some cost involved there, so that takes away from what we net, but it's been a win. And the time that goes into this is the setup. A lot of time that goes into the setup. Once you get the course set up, it's a matter of changing it, tweaking it here and there, keeping the material fresh and up to date, running the course after. But yeah, faculty have responded to the monetary incentive. Yes. I was there at the same time.
Yeah, I believe actually you were my TA. So I just have one more question.
You can all ask him after.
On the midterm. I think it was at 89.45. The benefit, no. The question though is more serious. At that time, Gerhard Casper and Condoleezza Rice, we're following the STEM sciences game plan where you pump tens of millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars into the STEM disciplines to elevate the already elevated and august reputation of Stanford, meaning at the same time not really putting very many resources into humanities and the arts.
I remember well.
Yes.
Students marched through Condoleezza Rice's office.
That's right, we did. I was there. So, here on this campus, there's a lot of talk about supporting STEM disciplines. There's a lot of talk of building new buildings for STEM disciplines. You, as the potential dean of both the arts and the sciences, how would you strike a balance between these disparate parts of the university?
I think absolutely you have to strike a balance. You've got to have, at a university, strong arts strong humanities, strong social science, strong science. I mean, there's no way around it. Students have to have a well-rounded education. And on top of that, you've got real strengths, real strength across the board in all of these areas. I think the worst thing that can happen is you let an area of national recognized strength shrivel up, because those are really difficult things to rebuild once you've got that reputation. Particularly in the humanities, you've got all a library collection that's centered on that. You might have an international studies program that's getting NRC or CLAS dollars from that, and that is something that's absolutely important. You've got to continue that. It is the case that the sciences are expensive. It is the case that you're not going to attract top scientists unless you've got new lab space for them. And I do think that that is something to consider, that you're going to have, if you're going to have a vibrant science program, that it's necessarily going to be more expensive than a history department, and there's no getting around that. So I do think there are reasons to give, I mean, there are obviously reasons to build a new science building. I mean, you've got to have labs if you're going to have a nationally ranked and a top science program and a top university. So I think absolutely there's reason for balance at the university. You've got some of the best humanities. So the list I had of top PhD programs, you look at that, a lot of them in the arts, a lot of them are in the humanities. And that's something that needs to further be developed. I think it's also the case, I mean, these things, I mean, if you look historically, interest in the sciences rises, interest in the humanities rises, it falls, it rises and falls. You don't want to have some sort of a knee-jerk, I'm a historian, I like to look back in time. You don't want to have a knee-jerk reaction by saying, well, the last 5 years we've seen decline, therefore we're going to cut this program. I think that's the wrong direction to go in. We've got to take a longer-term historical view. And if you read anything in the Chronicle of Higher Education these days, if you read any interviews with CEOs out in Silicon Valley, it is obvious that they value the humanities and the value of the arts. They're looking for people who are well-rounded, and I do think that these are important fields to support. So, yeah, I think balance is necessary, but at the same time, I'll repeat, I think that there are reasons that you're going to spend tens of millions, $200 million on a science building if the lab space itself is outdated and you need to do something about that. I'll leave it at that. You gonna march through my office?
I think we might have time for one or two more.
Okay, one or two more questions. Yes. Okay, I talked about the improvements in diversity.
And wanted to know your thoughts about some of the issues you want to address in the department here.
I don't, frankly, I don't know, I can't give you specifics. The data that I can pull from your website doesn't necessarily get down into that level. I went to the data website that has sort of overview of the statistics of the university and of the college broadly, but I can't speak specifically to any one department. That would be the kind of thing I would want to get involved in conversations with faculty themselves and also with chairs about what opportunities, what challenges are faced here, and to try to help come about with some new directions there. I do think that you have some really exciting studies programs, African American studies, African studies, Latin American studies, Asian studies, these sorts of things. And I think that those studies programs can be are very important, have the faculty who are associated there and the directors that are associated with those programs involved in these conversations, because I think that those units are quite excellent and quite strong. Possibilities there can be used to encourage change, but I'll leave it at that. Time for one more question, and then you can all go back to the Xerox machine and get your syllabi ready for tomorrow. Yes?
Hi, I'm an assistant professor in chemistry and computational research. Now, the problem with high-performance computing is that NSF and NIH, they don't want to pay for it through personal grants. So what they think is that universities should provide the infrastructure. And the problem with computers is that you need to buy new computers every 3 to 5 years because otherwise they become old, right?
That is the case in the sciences, and it's the case in the humanities.
Right.
This computer will not be sitting here in another couple of years.
Yes, but the
but yours cost a lot more than mine. Yeah, I mean, this is a budget issue and a budget allocation issue. It is absolutely the case that if you're going to get NSF money, NIH money, you've got to have the facilities and you've got to have the infrastructure. So if that is something that is important to the university, and I think it is, it should be, then that absolutely is something that you have to invest in. Again, I think if you're going to have top programs, that you need to find a way to make them top programs. Now, I'll refer back to something I said earlier. When I look around my own department, if I'm a dean, when I look around a college, I mean, you can't invest equally everywhere. There's just not enough money to go around. So what do you do? Do you just divide the pie up evenly, or do you try to put some money in some areas of excellence, either existing areas of excellence or new areas that you can build, I think, that have synergies with some of your existing areas of excellence, where you can conceivably go out and get some external funding. You need to think seriously about your return on investment. If I invest $1 million in this and attract a couple of new faculty members or make it possible for some of our existing faculty to advance their careers, what's the return on investment they're going to be? And if it looks positive, then I think absolutely you have to pursue that. You've got to develop these areas of strength and make your university, make your department known for something. So I think that's a commitment. Now, the budget is always in play. I showed you that pie chart, and you can increase you can be entrepreneurial and increase the pie by trying to convince the state to increase the appropriations. That's probably not going to happen. By attracting some international students and by being entrepreneurial, going out and find dollars that you never found before from some new audiences. And I think that's something that we all have to do.